Good afternoon to everyone. I'm happy that finally I could present this paper. It was, I presented this paper in the East Asian Association of Environment and Natural Resource Economies in Taipei last August, no, through the travel run from SEARCA, and I'm very thankful of that. This paper actually is part of a big project that we did entitled Environment and Food Security Interactions Amid Climate Change, which was funded by the Center for Integrative Studies, Integrative and Development Studies on the CIDS of UP. And this project got involvement from different colleges of UPLB, such as the College of Economics and Management, College of Agriculture, College of Forestry and Natural Resources, College of Arts and Sciences, and College of Human Ecology. So this is, this project is really an integrative, no, study, and the results, no, of the different components of the project has been published in a book. This one. And I'm going to give this topic to SEARCA for SEARCA Library. Okay, so this is the outline of my presentation, and it focuses only on evaluation of damage and the adaptation strategies that households are doing in a watershed due to an extreme event. In this case, we got data from households who were affected by Typhoon Inyoy from different elevations of Santa Cruz watershed. So this will be the, this is the outline of my presentation. And then, okay, why we study? Of course, we know that the Philippines is an active lighting country. And being at the Pacific Rim, the Philippines is a hot spot for the occurrence of natural hazards and climate change in those disasters. In fact, according to IPCC, the Philippines ranked third in terms of vulnerability to sea level rise and, of course, extreme events brought about by climate change. We all know that an average of 20 tropical cyclones pass our country today, every year, and out of these, 9 are really making landfall, causing tremendous damage to population, agricultural crops, and properties. And of course, we have experienced that recently, the frequency and occurrences of this typhoon became more pronounced. For example, we have this. In 2009, this typhoon raised havoc in Luzon. In 2012, Typhoon Pablo caused serious damage in Davao del Norte. And then, of course, in 2013, Typhoon Yolanda devastated Visayas. And in 2014, Typhoon Glenda also devastated Southern Luzon. We're lucky we don't have one yet since 2012. And of course, we all know also that after the damage, reports of the value has been given, no, by different agencies. But this damage focus did not include the damage incurred by households and community. Mostly these are based on the losses due to agricultural crops, losses, damage to infrastructures. So, as such, damage are underreported, and in making policy, households are more often neglected. I searched, no, literature, and I found only two studies to mention. This one, Adventure in 2008, Prego et al. In 2009, and Dr. Spaldon in 2014, have looked into the value of damage at the micro level, particularly in the very, very few, no? Okay, so this study is an attempt to provide additional information damage brought about by an extreme event. And as I have said, in this case, this is type 1 joint among the households in the Santa watershed. Why watershed? Of course, when we talk of watershed, it's an extreme watershed. But the common description of the watershed approach is the from ridge to cliff. So in this case, what we did was to look into several elevations along the watershed. And we consider the watershed approach because, as shown here, the elevation of community is located in place determines the kind of impact that the household will suffer from a disaster. Okay, and then disaster evaluation and coping mechanisms are also relative to a community's or household's location. For this study, as I have said, we considered elevations, and the size location were determined based on the meter above sea level. So based on the GIS done by Dr. Pifuran, so the site with MASL about 408 meters was classified as high elevation. From 20 to 407 as medium elevation, and less than 20 low elevation. So these are the elevations that we considered in our study. So these are the objectives, and in general, this study aims to assess the value of damages caused by an extreme event and coping mechanisms of households. Coping mechanisms that households take. These are the specific objectives to determine the types of damage suffered by households in different elevations, to assess the value of damages incurred by households in different elevations, and of course to estimate the value of the coping mechanisms of households in different elevations, and lastly to draw policy implications based on the results. The methodology is very simple. Now, much mathematical manipulation. Okay, so the place is of course the Santa Cruz watershed. The high elevation is represented by the municipality of Nagdarlan. Medium elevation, Iliu, and low elevation, Santa Cruz. And from each of these municipalities, we chose two barangays. And from these barangays, we were able to get 169 samples that we randomly chose, based of course on sampling design. Okay. The method of data gathering, household survey, using pre-tested questionnaire, focus group discussions. Our respondents here in the focus group discussions are of course the officials of the barangay, representative from LRB. If there is any organization in the barangay, we also got representative. And since we are concerned with food security and some indication of the national status, we also included in the focus group discussion the barangay headquarters. And for the key informants, this includes the people from the municipal offices, from the different agencies from the municipal office. So the representative from the municipal agricultural office, the RRMC, the ENR, the METHO, the ILG, and then planning and development office. And the secondary data were supported by, the primary data were supported by secondary data. We got information for the barangay integrated development plans regarding their plans for disaster risk reduction. And of course, the plans of the DRRM. Okay, this is the data gathered, the types of damages in crops and livestock, assets and properties, foregone income, because during a typhoon, people were not able to work, so they are forgotten. market-based approach, the cost of coping mechanisms, and the operative expenditures of the household, plus the value of organic income. And of course, to test for significance of the means of the different elevations, we use the analysis of variance. So very simple analysis. This is the location of our study. Oh, by the way, I put this because when I presented this in Taiwan, of course, I have to show them where is the study site. But this is the watershed. Okay, so this is the highest point now. And it's Nagarlan, Liliu, and Santapo. So these are the study areas. Okay. So the socioeconomic profile of the respondents, you would note that most of the respondents are male. We went to the household and asked what household had, and most of them are male. Of course, married, because most of them are married, but no single respondents. But the others are either widower or widower. For the education, we got the years of schooling, and you can see that most of them, we're not able to finish high school, this third year of high school. And as you can see here, a great part of the high school level, high school graduate, only 33%. And there are some college graduate, 21%. The primary occupation is, of course, it varies by location. Farming for the high elevation. For the medium elevation, the off-farm labor. And of course, for the low elevation, trade-related or service workers. And the average annual household income is relatively low. 175,000 on the average, but the highest will be on the medium elevation. And these are statistically significant, that's 5%. Okay, so based on our samples, the percent of households with car damages. So for the crops and livestock, you would know that at the high elevation, they have the highest percentage of about 50% of the household suffer damage due to crops and poultry or livestock. For the medium elevation, the damage is on properties. But for the low elevation, the damage are the losses due to unable to work. So you would note that as the elevation decreases, the percentages of those who incur damage due to crops and livestock also decreases. Actually, at the middle elevation, this is also agricultural, but mostly rice. At the high elevation, these are relatively the high value crops and the perennials. Okay, the value of damage, I did not include here the quantity because different measurement. But the value of damage, you can see that for as a whole, this is the total value of damage from crops, assets, and organic income by the high elevation. They have the highest. Okay. And then for the crops and livestock, here the value is 20,000, more than 20,000 per household. This is on a per household basis. For all respondents, this is the crops, no? The value of crops and poultry damage. For is the medium elevation at a relatively higher value, and the high and low elevation, more or less, they are statistically significant, almost the same value. This is the foregone income. You would note that those at the low elevation, they have the highest foregone income. And as a whole, for the whole, these are the values, no? On the average per household. And this is just for what depends on you, for low. Okay, so this is by type of damage. Okay, for the high elevation, again, you can see that this is the value of crops and poultry. The total value of damage is 26,000 per household. This is the sum of crops, assets, and organic income. Okay, and then for all respondents, okay, the highest value is on crops and poultry. I think I made a mistake here because the total value should be higher. What should be the sum of this? It's not the average. It should be the sum. Okay, to guide dito. Okay, so ito tama. Ito tama. Ito may be mali. Dapat it should be higher, no? Because 19 plus 3 plus 4. Okay. Okay, the share of damages, so you can see, no? The share of crops and livestock. The biggest. And for the low elevation, it is the low of the organ income. Okay, so these are on a per household basis. How about the aggregate? The aggregate for the 6 barangays that we studied. So in getting the aggregate, we did that simply multiply, no? By the number of households, but we got the percentage of the households who suffer the damage, and then get also the same percentage for the total households in the study areas. So the total value of for the 6 barangays is 43.46 million. The low elevation has the highest value because, of course, why? On a per household basis, they have relatively small. But the low elevation has more number of households. So, a small number multiplied by a bigger number of households resulted in higher aggregate or total damage for the low elevation. And the medium elevation, they have the lowest, no? Because based on our study, there are relatively fewer households in this area. Okay. But the total is this, no? It consisted of 4,855 households, the total. And the biggest contributor to the total is the foregone income because of the biggest loss here in the low elevation. Okay, so that's the value of damage. No? This is just the share which I got from the table. Okay. Now, how about the coping strategies? For them to cope, they should know when the typhoon is coming. No? So what we did, we asked them if they receive information about the typhoon. So here, most of them got information that there will be typhoon. And the major source of information is the television set. So, you would note that barangay officials have been rated, mentioned as the list, source of information. And we asked also about the time when they receive information, because if they receive the information in advance, they can prepare. And in number of hours, more or less, these are not statistically significant. So on the average, they know that the typhoon is coming 24 hours before it, the typhoon landed. Okay, now, the coping strategies all did. No? Coping strategies before, during, and after the typhoon. But you can see that the strategies are, we call this the autonomous adaptation of coping mechanism. Mostly, no? They buy and stuff. Takot na hutong, no? Okay? So, ito, no? 75% for the high elevation household. And then 53% and 55% for the medium and low elevation households, respectively. During the typhoon, mababa yung may mga diwa, no? Because of course they stayed at home and mamaya matatawa kayo sa coping strategies nila, no? And for those, no, who did strategies during the typhoon, they reinforced the house, secure house, and then relocate family. After the typhoon, mostly repair and then reinforce the house. Which is, ano, parang totoo naman na nasira ng bahay. Okay. Days to recover. We asked them, how long were you able to recover? Those at the low elevation, 46 days. No? Before they recover. And I think this is, ano, relatively true because I understand those yung malapit sa Laguna Lake, no? They suffer too much from flooding. Okay, so those at the high and medium elevations, just 2 weeks they were not able to work, to recover, because we attended to damaged properties. So the value of coping strategies, ito, before the typhoon, maliliit, no? Yung value, no? But I thought 131 pesos, 26 pesos per household. But after the typhoon, so ang lalaki ng values nila, no? So this is on a per household basis. And then the share, of course, majority of the value of coping strategies were incurred, no? After the typhoon. And hindi nagkakalayo, no? By education. Now, during the typhoon, he asked, what is your coping mechanism? Wala, nagdadasal na lang. So, something like that. Yeah. Okay. And then this is the value, the aggregate, no? So the aggregate value of coping mechanism for the same, no, number of households is very small compared to the value of damage. It's only 8.7 million. And those at the low elevation, they have the highest value of coping mechanism. Okay. So bakit din, no? Okay. Okay. Now, the coping mechanisms of dun sa, ano, sa low elevation, because they have another to repair, other to repair of their appliances, no? So they have this. Okay, so this is only on the aggregate after the typhoon, so 6 million is the average. And then is the share after the typhoon, then. And here, I compare the value of damage versus the value of coping mechanisms. Ang laki ng difference, almost 5 times yung value of damage. So the difference is 35 million. Ang laki ng why? Okay. So, the implication that I could say here is that, of course, these people are relatively low income, no? So the value of damage is too high, but they were not able, no, to do something. And of course, it's because their adaptation mechanism is autonomous. No? They have no planned strategies. So, so they were not, they don't have the sufficient fund or money or financial support to do a long-term coping mechanism. So, tignan nyo naman yung coping mechanism niya. Inilipat yung bagong, inilipat yung kanilang gamit sa kapit-baryo, So, may value sa kanila, But of course, yung long-term adaptation, wala. So, I think that's the implication that I could say here, They don't have the long-term adaptation, which is important these days of our climate change. Okay, so from this, what conclusions? So damage due to calamity is different by location, and this implies that if we are going to do some adaptation or support services, then we can attempt a blanket. A blanket recommendation or blanket strategy, rather should be site specific. And that is one of the problems that we have now. We don't have the specific need. Okay, so here it is very glaring that those in the upland and who are engaged in agriculture suffer more on the average due to typhoon. On the other hand, those at the lowland, they suffer from typhoon due to flood, which render them unable to report for work. So, yung damage sa kanila ay from the earnings. They were, for 46 days, they were not able to work. Okay, so, and then those at the high elevations have lower value of coping mechanisms, which are purely, as I have said, autonomous in nature. Okay, and then on the aggregate, those in the low elevation have highest value of damage due to number of people exposed to the calamity. So, relatively urban na ito eh. Okay, and then on the aggregate, yun nga, nakita natin discrepancy between the value of damage and their ability to cope. So, as such, policy related to long-term adaptation of agriculture to typhoon and any climate industries must be strengthened. So crop varieties that can withstand strong winds and flooding must be introduced. And I just read sa FB, sinabi ni Dr. Bruce Tolentino that they have already areas developed climate change resistant rice. Okay. Those living in the low-lying areas must be helped through infrastructure improvement, siguro yung good drainage facilities, and of course, solid waste management. And I added also that programs on disaster preparedness and early warning system at the barangay level must also be strengthened. So ito din yung sinasabi ng ating mga barangay officials na ano bang, paano ba namin malalaman, Although I understand, may mga ginagawa ng mga napaka-simple, simple parang early warning system, At sa isang numero sa bubo, Pag ganito na kadami yung tubig, okay, relocate mo tayo, And of course, sa Manila, sa Marikina, nung travel ako sa Ilocos, nakita ko yung mga flood-prone areas, meron silang mga measure na may mga how many feet na yung flood, So, and then, households are, or officials are, trained, na if the flood is up to here, then prepare for the location. But I think, there are, other, more, to be done. So, in terms of our preparedness, I think, that's if you have questions, then I'll be ready to answer.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Sumalde, for that very interesting presentation. And thank you for sharing. sharing with us the results of your study on the value of damage incurred at the household level during extreme events. So the floor is now open for your questions, comments, and insights. Yes, Miriam.
Hi. Thank you very much, Dr. Sumalde, for the presentation. First, let me just say that the fact that the low-level household, those in the lower elevation households suffer the most, this validates also the results of a study that was conducted by SEARCA. Actually, Kim Bayani was part of that. And yes, they were mostly in the lowland areas who suffered the most when it came to typhoons and flooding. Okay, having said that, one question is, because you said they are very poor, there are such low-income families that they could not afford to have to cope with everything that needed to be done. Were they, did they ever talk about availing of microfinancing, for example? Because I know at one particular point after a typhoon, I was at CART MRI, and they said they were giving off loans to poor families who were greatly hit by the typhoon. So I wonder if you ever asked the question in the course of the study, and if they ever availed of it.
Actually, that's part of our study. But unfortunately, very few. And if ever they borrow from relatives. They borrow from relatives.
During po nung survey po ninyo, did you also include the local government officials in your survey?
Yeah, it's a focus group discussion.
So, nung sinabi niyo po ma'am na yung discrepancy nga po between the value of coping mechanism and the damage incurred. So, kung alam po na ng local government unit yung discrepancy dun sa value, ano po kaya yung mga measures na ginagawa nila ngayon para namang bulungit yung discrepancy?
Actually, yung sinasabi nila, we have funds for relief. So, autonomous din eh. No? Autonomous din. And, doon sa community, meron diyang part mo, yung chapter 8 yata. Chapter 8. Yung community adaptation. Ang sinasabi palagi nila ay, yun nga, ang kanila na ano, for relief, for relocation, something like that. But sana ang hinahanap natin yung they would find sa ways na, halimbawa, ano kaya yung mga possible na livelihood. No? Walang ganun eh. Parang ano lang yung, yun nga, ang kanila, sabi nila, actually sa munisipyo, meron yung kami parang yung pampo, something like that. No? And then yun nga, sinasabi nila na, mayroon ka rin book fund for relief, no? So, gano'n, no? So, parang, ang inaano sana namin, yun na sana na magkaroon ng program na what other crops, no? Na pwede nilang anuhin, no? So, sinabi namin na wala ho bang plano, for example, especially sa infra, no? Sabi nila, ang hirap magplano, nasa dapat nasa niyan, nasa administration yan, something like that, no? So, medyo ano, or siguro kailangan pa din ng in-depth, no? In-depth talaga na understanding ng problem. Kasi ito, parang, it is just, I think, 15-month study, and then it covers pati yung pest nila, yung soil and water management, so medyo ano, and then ang liit-liit ng budget, so we were not able, kasi gusto namin nalaki pa yung sample, you know? Hindi nga, no? Pero, yes sir.
Yes, Dr. Mauricio.
Si Sir Dali ay nandito. Yan ang pwede sa seminar. Ayaw mo din nila.
Thank you, Dr. Sumalde, for that very interesting discussion, presentation. I'm a forester, so I would like to ask you, if you ask or question the DNR and the NGO, if that watershed area is satisfactory or very good, because it appears that it is not a very good water, effective watershed, because the cost or the value of disaster in the lowland is greater than in the island and in the region. So it appears that the wind and the rain, water from the rains, travel to the lowland. If the watershed was affected, there should be very low almost no value of damage in the lowland, because the trees or the forest prevented the flood in the lowlands. So, I would like to join you in encouraging the government and the people to improve their watershed, because the results of your study is very good. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It's a very good question.
Actually, yun nga po natin naging yung problema, mukhang sira yung ating watershed, no? And I understand, I attended the seminar of Dr. Cruz, no? They have funding for the networking of these different watersheds, no? All over the country. So, meron nung ginagawang study si na Dr. Cruz tungkol sa networking and how, no? How they could capacitate the local government for sa management ng watershed.
And I would like to suggest or recommend that the DNR and the local government and the people there join in improving the watershed by minimizing smuggling of forestries. Timber stand improvement and enrichment planting, so that the water, the rain, when it reaches the soil, is already very, very, what it was, very, very small, so that there is no flood going to the lowlands. Thank you very much.
Meron na po tayong national grading program na nagtatarget ng how many billion trees?
6
billion trees to plant in 1.5 million hectares. Pero yun nga po, sana po, yung ating national breeding program, yung monitoring ng yung survival, no? Kasi ang dami-dami na namin na itanim na puno eh, pero yung survival po siguro ang kulang, yung monitor, yung survival ng ating mga tree planting activities. Tingnan po natin sa susunod.
May follow-up question po si Mayor. Sorry. Aking senior, okay, remember na. Yung sa DRRM, yung mga plans ng bawat municipality, wala ka doon na kasama na mas long-term planning kaysa masyadong stopgap yung kanila. Because I remember, relating to the study that I mentioned earlier, where King Bayani was, of which King was a part, I nabanggit ko, several suggestions. She actually did a cost-benefit analysis of the various suggestions, recommendations that were made. And one was yung putting up a more or less permanent evacuation center, something like that, and other infrastructure innovations in the various households that were presented. Para hindi na masyadong apektado ng flooding. It would, of course, involve a lot more of investments. But then, again, kasama dun sa plano yung mga suggestions kung paano din makuha yung pera na kakailanganin. So I wonder if anything has been done along that line.
Mukhang nagsisimula.
And I understand yung mga programs na to capacitate talaga yung mga members ng DRRMC.
local level. No? Kasi we cannot again, para pag nabigla tayo eh. No? Hindi, para pag we don't expect no, na ganito ang magiging efekto sa atin. Example na lang yung Visayas, di ba? They admitted na at the local level, hindi sila lahat na doon sa ganoong level. Parang they did not expect na ganun ang magiging effect. But, nakikita ko, may mga permanent population centers na, no? So, sabi ko, man, pumunta ako ng Ilocos sa mga bayan na dinaanan namin. Doon na lang sa Ilocos Sur, no? Lahat ng bayan. Meron na nakaaraw na two permanent relocation site. And then, may, parang may mga, no, may mga structure na. Meron na gano'n, no? But of course, siguro ko lang pa rin, no? In terms of how to be handled, no? People, no? Who are at the relocation sites. Siguro.
Yes. Question. Si May Ward.
Hi, boss. Good afternoon po, Bansin. One of your conclusions says that those living in the low-lying areas must be helped through infrastructure improvements. Example is the good drainage facilities. Ma'am, can you say that in the low-lying areas, which is in Santa Cruz, the only major infrastructure that is improvement is the drainage facilities only?
Example only.
Ma'am, what other infrastructure can you say that needs improvement in those low-lying areas?
Ay, yung mga ano, pero elevated ano, bridges. Ginagawa na ito in other areas, no? Na tinataasan na nila yung bridges. So people can ano, can cross. At saka yung mga roads pinapatungan na, no? Matataas na. Kaya lang pag bumahagi sa hospital, kasi nga mataas na yung road, no? Road plan. But yun nga, drainage talaga, importante yun eh. Especially so na, yun nga, nagtaas sila ng mga roads. So, pinatungan, ang taas talaga. Pero yung drainage, hindi naman nila nilaliman. Kaya nangyari, doon, pumupunta naman sa household doon.
Ma, another clarification or related to programs on disaster preparedness and early warning systems at the barangay level must also be strengthened. Ma'am, can you rate the preparedness of the LGUs or the,
how can
very poor or...
Hindi naman siguro very poor, pero kulang na kulang. Especially so pag nag-change, no? Kung nag-change ng, administration or management, so, pero tingin ko kulang pa. But of course, may mga magagaling na tayo ng example, Marikinas, maganda na. Alibay, maganda na. Pero karamihan ay kulang na kulang pa.
Ma, kasi we know na, di ba, meron ng policy na talagang may budget allotted to disaster preparedness. So, we can say ba na hindi nasusunod yung allotment to
preparedness? I don't know. Okay, kasi, at saka is the budget din. Oh, yun na nga siguro. Kasi yung planning kasi, di ba dapat long term yung planning? So, is the budget enough? Yung adaptation niya. That's the question.
Yes.
Thank you. I cannot give concrete answer. Honestly. Yes, po.
Thank you. Okay. This morning, at 10 o'clock, this morning, I believe there was a location here in forestry wherein the planting of high value crops in the uplands, the forest, was signed. Would you recommend this to be done here in the watershed? The planting of high value so that the effect of watershed management would improve.
Siguro naman po, if I am not mistaken, this is the project of Dr. Abasolo with DNR, no, and they will put, no, also nursery for high value trees here, no? Siguro naman sir, nakikita ko, they will be selective kung saan nila ilalagay yung mga, sa mga appropriate site.